I pushed the record button. This is Ham Radio Now, episode number 411, Team Exuberance. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG. I'm supposed to do this flying. Let's see if that worked. I think it worked. And today, I've got another new and exciting episode for you. It's another interview. And this time, it's with a youth that's into amateur radio. And so I'd like to introduce to you Violetta. Hi, Violetta. How are you doing today?
Hi. Pretty good.
Good. So Violetta is part of, you're the leader for Team Exuberance. Is that right?
Yeah, sort of. I mean, I'm the one who kind of got the idea started and stuff, but there's been a lot of help from other people too.
And how many people are on the team?
There's 6 kids.
Uh-huh. And how did it come together?
Basically, whenever I was down on the Dave Coulter Memorial Youth DX Adventure of 2018, at the end of the week, us kids were talking about, we wanted to get together again and stuff. And we were we were talked about getting together for a contest or something. Mm-hmm. And so kind of threw ideas around and stuff. And we kind of after we went home and stuff, I did some research and got together with Tim Duffy and threw around some ideas. And he's like, yeah, that'd be great. We could use his station and stuff. So kind of did some more planning and
So the Dave Coulter Youth DX Adventure, you guys went to Costa Rica? Is that right?
Curacao.
Oh, Curacao. Okay, right.
Yeah.
And
Curacao.
And how many youth? You said 6 youth went out there?
There was 4 youth down there.
There were 4 youth down there. And how long did you operate?
Yeah.
When you were down there, how long?
We were down there for a week, but there was about 8 hours of operating time that we lost because of there was power outages and stuff. Mm-hmm.
But you operated for most of the rest of the week?
Yeah.
Wow. That was long term. And CW, phone, digital, all the modes?
We did a lot of FT8, CW, and phone. That's about it, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And you operate all 3 of those modes yourself?
I did some FT8 for the first time. It was really cool. Uh-huh. I made 1 CW contact and that's it. Uh-huh. And yeah, mostly phone mostly though. Phone.
Okay. Okay. And tell me, how'd you get into amateur radio?
Basically, it was through my dad. It was kind of a family thing. even when I was growing up really little, we had ham radios around our house and stuff. Mm-hmm. So he kind of taught us the Morse code. I was 9 years old when I got my technician.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How old are you now?
Yeah.
How old are you
14.
Now? You're 14. And class license do you hold?
I have an extra.
Extra. How long did it take you to go from technician to extra?
I was 9 when I got my technician. Uh-huh. And then I studied for that over the summer. And then the next summer I studied for my general and extra.
Mm-hmm. And you did all
so it was about.
All at one time. How did you study?
What?
How did you study for that? I'm jealous because I haven't quite made extra yet.
Yeah, I used Gordon West, WB6NOA. He has licensed study manual books.
Uh-huh. And did you just study?
That was what I used to study.
Just from the books then?
Yeah, basically I had to memorize a lot because, I was 10 years old. I didn't know what half they were talking about. So.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
But that worked.
And how many members at home are hams?
There's 9 in our family and there's 8 licensed. The youngest is 6. Yeah.
Not quite ready yet.
Yeah.
And are you the oldest or in the middle somewhere? Or?
No. I'm the middle child. Yeah. The oldest is 18. Mm-hmm. The youngest licensed one is 10.
Mm-hmm. So I guess through all the years you kind of grew up doing field day and other operating stuff. Okay. Very cool. Very cool. At least one of my daughters has been doing field day with me for probably 8 years now. And kind of similar situation in my house. There's 7 people and 6 of the 7 all have their licenses. Most of them are technicians, but
that's pretty cool.
Yeah. It's fun. It's fun. So how did you get, I have this Dave Coulter site up here. How did you get connected with them? To do this trip in Curacao?
Well, like, I first heard about it from some of my friends. They had gone on previous ones and kind of told me a little bit about it and stuff. That's where I first learned about it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's great. Oh, yeah, so I see four youth and four adults. Did one of your parents go along, or?
Yeah, my dad went along with me.
Uh-huh. Did he get
I was the only girl on the whole team.
Okay. Did he get to operate too, or was really just limited to the youth?
He made one contact.
He made one. And that's all right.
Yeah.
That's all right. I don't see any pictures here on the pages. Let's see. Maybe I can find a page here. What was the most challenging thing about going to Kirkow and operating?
It was pretty hard. Like, the biggest thing for me was basically, like, the time schedule we had down. We didn't have any time change, but I'm used to like going to bed at 8 o'clock, getting up at 5 a.m. And whenever we go down there and we go to bed at like 1 a.m. and then get up at like 8 o'clock the next morning, it was a little bit hard, but
it was hard. It was fun. That. Yeah. And they were there. It was serious operating. Was it kind of round the clock like that? When you were up, if somebody was always sitting in the chair, running radios.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Pretty much. There was twice that like the power went out, like on pretty much all the island. Two different days. It was about 8 hours total that we missed operating, but other than that, it was fairly steady. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And
there was one day we did take off and go to the Capitol.
Uh-huh.
And just kind of like walk around and stuff.
Uh-huh. That sounds like a lot of fun. Would you do it again?
Yeah.
If you could.
Yeah, definitely.
So that's like near Venezuela. And you guys flew through directly to that island, or did you fly to?
No, the meetup place for the team was in Miami, Florida.
Uh-huh.
I flew from Baltimore to Atlanta, Georgia, and then from Georgia to Miami, where we met the team. And then from Miami, it was straight down.
Okay, that sounds like a lot of fun. And so you formed some long-term friendships there, and then you guys decided you want to do something else. Tell me about Team Exuberance.
Okay, basically the idea was like a couple like last days we were operating, us kids were getting together talking about we wanted to, you know, keep in touch and maybe get together, operate together again.
Mm-hmm.
So we talked about like doing a contest together sometime, because a lot of the kids there liked contesting, and I also knew several other kids that really love contesting.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, we went home, kind of talked about it. I went to Hamvention 2018. Talked with some of my other youth friends who are contesters, and I went to DX Engineering open house, talked to Tim there about it. He said, yeah, it'd be a great idea if we want to use his station. And so we kind of threw ideas back and forth, got together our rough team, and yeah, just kind of went from there, started planning, and yep.
And that's that station is that K3LR station, is that the one you're talking about? That's where you guys are going next.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And where is that located?
It's like near the Ohio-Pennsylvania border.
Mm-hmm.
But it's on the Pennsylvania side.
Okay. And it's a big contest station.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. When you guys were, when we talk about back to Kirkow, when you guys were down there, the station that you went and used, is that sponsored by someone? Did you have any specific equipment there that you guys used, or just whatever the host had? Or did you bring stuff along?
Yeah, basically, like, the whole, it was like a contest station down there already, like, right on the edge of the island. PJ2T was the name of the station. I've seen pictures of it before. That was the first time I've ever been there.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it was fairly big. Yeah, it was, all the stuff was there already and everything.
Uh-huh. How many radios did you guys run at a time?
We had the sideband one, the CW one, and then we had the FT8.
Gotcha. So you guys were running three stations. And it was it just primarily the four youth, or was it the four youth and the four adults running when you guys were down there?
Primarily the youth, since like this was a youth oriented thing.
Mm-hmm.
The youth had first priority. The adults got on some, and that was like, yeah, whenever the youth were taking a break or some, which was pretty fun. Yeah.
Cool. So I you reached out to me to find out if I was going to be at Dayton hoping to do an interview, and I really appreciate you making yourself available. Unfortunately, I can't make it to Dayton this year. And the talk was about Team Exuberance, and I know you guys are running a GoFundMe, and I'll pull that up on the screen here and show that off. So the GoFundMe is helping you guys all travel in the end of March this year to this K3LR superstation to participate in the TQ Worldwide. Is that's the goal?
Yeah, the worked prefix, WPX.
WPX. So tell me about what the WPX is.
It's like the last weekend of March, the 29th to 31st. It runs from Friday night at 8 o'clock to Sunday night at 8 o'clock. And we basically see how many different prefixes we can work. The exchange is like, the serial number and stuff like that.
So you're talking about different, is it country prefixes that you're trying to collect?
I don't think so. Just the different prefixes.
Just any different prefix.
Like, yeah.
Says there's, the six of you. So Violet, Bryant, David, Tommy, Levi, and Marty. And I know Marty, Marty sat in the studio here with me previously and I've interviewed him before. You guys are all going to go down there and operate, and that's just a weekend. I guess it's just a 2-day contest.
It's Friday night to Sunday night, so most of the team is planning to go Thursday and then leave Monday morning.
And you guys stay there at is that like a farm or something like that? Stay there at the contest station?
We actually have a hotel down the road. It's just like 5-10 minutes up the road, so it's not far.
Got it.
Okay,
that sounds like fun. And you guys are fundraising, and it looks like you're about $350 short right now of your $5,000 goal, and I'll put that up again, and maybe we'll get you a little bit of advertising here. It's gofundme.com/team-exuberance. Maybe a couple of the listeners here will help get you guys to that $5,000 goal. The GoFundMe, you I don't know a whole lot about that. Do you get the money even if you don't make your goal, or you have to reach the goal to receive the funds?
No, I think if we were like pretty careful with careful with our money and stuff, we could do the trip how it is now.
Uh-huh.
But I'm trying to look at the page. I actually haven't been there since like 2 days ago. But yeah, we're getting really close to our goal, and I was really excited about that.
Yeah, look, it looks like right now I pulled it up here, and it's on the screen. $350 short. You're $4,650 of the $5,000 goal, and it looks like you guys are raising money to travel there, hotel and food expenses, and any other expenses you guys have. Some of the operators. So
yes.
It looks like one of the operators, David's coming from Canada.
Yep.
And it's always hard to tell when you look at people's call signs where they're coming from. There's a six Levi's from Sixland, although he may not be. I don't know if you know where he is.
Yeah, he's from California.
He's from California. Okay. All right. Yep. Well, that's cool. What's your guys' goal for the weekend contest wise? You guys have a target?
Well, we're entering the multi-tube category.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, well, basically our target is to
win.
Score number one.
To win,
to get first place. It's going to be a little bit tough because, I mean, this group of kids, we haven't operated together before. Uh-huh. We're going to, try to get some operating time in before the contest starts. I mean, we've operated on, different multi-teams, but we haven't, operated together, so that's going to be a little bit tricky. I know there's a lot of other large stations entering multi-tube. We definitely will have some competition.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah. what do you think is the biggest challenge? So is this a multi-radio setup that you'll be able to use there? Obviously that's a big station, the K3LR. Will you guys won't be just running one radio, be running multi-op, multi-radio?
We're entering multi-two, so we can beyond two bands, and then we have two radios for each band, a search and pounce, and then a call.
Okay. Run frequency. And the plan is to just kind of power through the weekend. You guys will, so there's six of you. There can be folks working all the time. Do you guys pair up as a as an operator and a scribe, or you guys work solo?
Yeah, we'll probably have four people on at a time. Like one shift is four people, so we'll have to like, yeah, I'm not exactly sure how we're gonna do that yet, but yeah, we don't have quite enough for a full rotation. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it'll be pretty cool.
And then just all weekend long, and you guys will shuttle back and forth through the hotel, sleep a little here, sleep a little there.
Yep.
Not like field day. I know field day, sometimes somebody will lay out a sleeping bag somewhere, but this sounds a little more civilized than that.
Yeah.
Very cool. Very cool. So you're 14. Any thoughts about your future? Amateur radio have a part in that as you grow up?
Well, right now I'm looking at electrical engineering. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I mean, yeah, that would have a little bit to do with ham radio, I guess. Sure. But yeah, I'm doing a lot of research on that right now. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I have a couple more years till I start looking at college, but that's pretty much what I'm looking at right now.
That's exciting. Okay. So what else would you want our listeners to know about youth and amateur radio? You know, how do we, one of the challenges I always have, I do a lot of scouting, and mm-hmm. we're always trying to do Jamboree on the Air, and
yep.
you know, we have a number of youth in our troops that have their radio licenses, and you know, we will carry radios around when we do things. You know, how is it that you talk to your friends about amateur radio, and have you, you know, been able to pull some in and get them excited about what it is that you do?
Yeah, a little bit. I have done a couple jamborees on the air. That was pretty fun.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't had a whole lot of interest from my friends, basically because they think the whole thing is cool. Mm-hmm. As soon as they hear the part about having to get a license, they're like, no way.
Makes it a little harder for them. Okay. And when you said you did Jamboree on the Air, do you participate with scouting, or were you went to help out, or?
I did go to help out. I am part of an exploring group that is based on communications, so that's pretty cool. That's like, we do some ham radio stuff in that.
Uh-huh. And what other things do you do with that? We're just kind of getting into exploring in Southern California. What else do you do beyond amateur radio and the communications?
Just this last week was the school club roundup. I took my dad's portable station set up at school. I would like to get like a station in the school, but I doubt that's going to happen. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that was pretty cool. We got some kids on the air. That was a lot of fun.
That's your high school?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. And did you get a good turnout for that? They were interested?
Yeah, we didn't make a whole lot of contacts. It's less than I was hoping, mm-hmm. but I still think like just getting the other kids on the air, it was pretty cool. They were, I mean, of course, you know, it was their first contact. They were a little bit scared, but they did actually pretty good. Yeah. So
Mike Fright can,
I was happy we could make any. So
yeah. Mike Fright can be hard in the beginning.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember it definitely was for me.
How active are you in amateur radio? Are you using radio on you guys have a station at home? Are you using it on a regular basis? Are you making, you know, local contacts or DX contacts or?
Yeah, I do. I was using our family station for a year, mm-hmm. and my dad's compromise with me is like, well, it was kind of his station, and anytime he wanted to be on it, I'd be sitting in the chair. So he's like, okay, I'm going to make a deal with you. If you can work 100 countries in a year, like from my station, mm-hmm. then he will buy me my own HF radio. So I was like, deal. So I started then. I didn't have a whole lot of experience when I started really, mm-hmm. but yeah, I got it in 11 months. I had 101 DX entities worked. So he bought me a Yaesu FT950.
Uh-huh.
So that's what I'm using right now. I just recently purchased an Ameritron AL80B amplifier,
uh-huh.
and I'm still like getting that, like the right like grounding in and everything. So that's not quite up yet, but yeah, it's pretty cool.
And do you have like beam antennas or?
I wish. Like, my dad has a tower, but I just have an off-center fed ZEP right now. Okay. I'm hoping I can upgrade soon, but.
So the station you have doesn't quite have the oomph that dad's does.
Yeah.
So
I'm trying to figure out some way I can like wire mine to his tower without him knowing, but. Wait, is he gonna watch this?
Probably.
Just kidding.
Probably. But when he's not in the chair, he's still letting you use the big tower.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. But like sometimes during contests and stuff, and he's not gonna be operating, and I'm having like some trouble with my station or something, he'll let me use his. So he's pretty nice about that.
And how about your siblings? Are they as active as you?
Kind of like all my older three sisters, they're not really much into it anymore. Mm-hmm. I do have a younger sister, Violetta Latham KM4ATT. She just was at Hamcation this last weekend. She spoke at the youth forum there. I don't think she's as much into contesting as I am, but yeah, she definitely likes to get on the radio too.
And so if she's not as much into contesting, does she do other stuff?
Yeah, she likes more, like she's getting into satellites right now, which is, I think it's pretty cool. I've never actually done it myself, mm-hmm. but yeah, okay. She's more into more chasing DX and stuff like that.
Got it. And so do you, as a family, do you do regular work like local, I don't know, Aries or Races or other, you know, community support kinds of activities?
Yeah, sometimes like we go to like bike races, help with communication, stuff like that. Mm-hmm. We do field days as a family somewhat, mm-hmm. and other activities like that, yeah.
Do you do that as part of a different group, or is it just your family, just the Latham family field day?
No, like we do it with our local club, uh-huh. and also our exploring group. Yeah, we kind of all go together.
And how many years have you been doing that?
Field day, this is what, my third year, I think. Yeah. This last winter field day was my second winter field day.
Yeah.
It was really cold, but
it was cold. How does that compare for you, winter field day versus the regular field day activity?
Summer field day.
Yeah.
Summer. I definitely like summer field day a lot more. Last summer field day, I stayed up like the entire weekend. Mm-hmm. I think we logged a couple hundred contacts. I don't remember exactly how many, mm-hmm. but yeah, that was a whole lot of fun. This last winter field day wasn't quite as productive, mm-hmm. and it was really cold. So
really
yeah,
cold.
I definitely like summer field day a bit better.
Yeah. And do you guys operate that outside? They're really cold. The winter.
Yeah.
The winter
we had like, day? It was in a pavilion. They had like tarp around it and a heater in there, but yeah, it still
doesn't keep up
as warm.
Yeah. In Southern California, yeah. Winter field day is almost like summer field day, except
true.
Not as much. You know, the thing is here, there's not as much action because not as many people go out and do it. That's what it seemed like to me, because I've tried a couple times and just done it locally. We go out with our Aries group for summer field day, but winter field days, it seems kind of slow. There's like not as many people out there. You have to go really hunting around to find a contact. Is it the same thing on the East Coast?
Yeah.
So
like during winter field day, I noticed like during the night, it's like the same six stations up and down the band.
Yeah.
That there wasn't a whole lot during the night, but yeah, it was fun, pretty fun during the day.
That seems like that's always my summer field day. You know, I get up at 4:30 or 5 in the morning and I talk to the same five or six stations, and we keep hitting each other on every band, you know, okay, we're here, now we're there. And I guess that's kind of how it goes. People slow down or the band conditions change. I found your QRZ site, and there's you operating. Is that the middle of the night?
Yeah, it's like 4 in the morning, I think.
4 in the morning, and that's a Vibroplex?
Yeah, okay. It's my dad's.
Your dad's? Cool.
That was our family station at our old house.
At the old house, uh-huh. And this is your dad?
Yeah.
I just talked to him on the phone.
Yep, that's my dad and me.
A couple minutes ago.
Right, oh, okay.
I called you. And I guess these are, so here's some of the pictures of the Dave Coulter event.
Yeah.
You guys all got matching t-shirts.
I just recently.
Go ahead.
Yeah, just recently went in and edited that. So there's quite a few more pictures than there were.
I guess hats were a big thing.
We had like a million and two hats.
That's cool.
There
you are. And some of the operators. All right. That's a great looking group there. And so this is the station.
It was like during the, yeah.
Uh-huh.
we had some time to play around and stuff whenever the power went out. So
yeah. That's got to be frustrating.
Because, I mean, it was fun because, like, I mean, in a way it was frustrating because we couldn't get on the air, but then we didn't have to feel guilty for not being on the air and we could, like, have some fun. But yeah, it was a lot of fun.
Uh-huh.
The whole week was, even operating. Yeah.
And so this is going there or coming home? This picture here.
That's actually going there. Yeah, that's the airport in Curacao. Uh-huh. That was my first time flying, so it was really cool.
Oh, that's exciting, huh?
Yeah.
It looks beautiful there. Iguana. Very nice. Very nice. So your younger siblings, you said the youngest one doesn't have a license yet, not quite ready to learn. Boy, that's a scary
crowd. Yeah, not quite ready. no kidding.
Are you, were there a lot of those crabs everywhere you turn around in the island?
Not really. I only saw like two the whole week, but there was one in the station we were operating. There was one on the floor one day. That was kind of cool.
And that's
it wasn't quite that big.
That's a pretty amazing tower.
Yeah, it was an amazing station down there.
Wow. So your youngest, you guys will bring her along, I guess, when she comes. Is it she or he?
The youngest is a girl, Belinda.
Okay. And you guys are bring her along in the amateur radio. Do you try to get your other brothers and sisters to come work at least your radio or your dad's radio now and then? Are they receptive of that?
Yeah, a little bit. My dad's radio, like the family station, is a little bit more complicated than like my station. Dad actually set up a special station for the younger kids just so they could, like, it doesn't have as many, like, it's not as complicated. You don't have to tune it as, like, fine and stuff like that.
Uh-huh.
So, yeah, they get on every now and then.
Okay, that's great. That's great. And you kind of Elmer them along?
Yeah, a little bit.
Super, super. All right. Well, anything else you want to tell the audience about this, this activity that you guys are going to go do in March, other than try to make some contacts?
Yeah, definitely. If you hear us on the air, please give us a call.
Uh-huh. And whose call are you guys going to use for that event?
We're going to use Tim, K3LR, Kilo 3 Lima Radio.
The K3LR. Okay.
For the contacts? Yep.
All right. And so I guess you guys will be the only ones working from there during that period?
Yep.
Very exciting. Okay. Well, so let's see. We talked about that and the other event. What plans do you have maybe for next year? Anything you guys are thinking about yet? Or you personally? You're going to be at Dayton.
Yeah, I'm going to be at Dayton. I'm going to be giving a presentation at the contest forum about the whole trip because by then we would have had it.
Uh-huh.
And so... Yep.
Very exciting. Very exciting. Okay. Well, I think I'm not sure I have any other questions for you today. I will definitely try to get on the air and work you guys that weekend and really wish I could be there to listen to the Dayton Forum. Are you guys going to try to record it and put it up on YouTube somewhere?
Yeah, I'm not exactly sure. I'm guessing they will, but I haven't figured that out yet.
Okay. All right. Very good. Well,
I'm hoping they will.
Well, I'm hoping they will too. Well, I'm hoping too. So some of my audience will enjoy this show and maybe they'll go look at the GoFundMe site and maybe help you guys reach your $5,000 goal.
Yep.
All right. Very good. Maybe after you guys are done, we'll figure out a follow up. Maybe we'll have a follow on show and maybe you could get one of the other operators to join in and we could talk about how it went, what went well and where your challenges are. I really always like to talk about the good and the bad and the ugly of amateur radio, you know. Like you said, you guys went down and you had power out for some hours. That can make it challenging, but sometimes you learn too, you know, patience and how to overcome obstacles and opportunities. Well, so... I want to thank you for joining me today and I will post this up, and feel free to share this out with your friends and other competitors. And again, I'm hoping maybe we can help drive you guys over that $5,000 goal. So
thank you very much.
You're very welcome. So I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, and I'll let you introduce yourself one more time.
I'm Violetta, KM4ATT.
Very good. And this was Ham Radio Now, episode number 411. Have you ever watched the show to the end? Do you know how we end it?
I have not.
No? Okay, so you might catch on. When we're done, I'll say the number again and the title of the show, and then I'm going to give a three-word phrase, and I'll do the first two and see if you can get the last one. This was Ham Radio Now, episode number 411, Team Exuberance. I'm David Goldenberg. Over and
out.
Excellent. You got it. Wait, now I'm supposed to do this other thing too. Woohoo! All right, I don't know if that worked or it didn't work. Oh, yeah, it did work.